Hi everyone, and welcome to our channel. In this episode, I'd like to take a look at the ever-popular Celtic Weave. Within the Vectric software, there are examples that we can use for our design purposes. In Aspire, we are given both 3D components as well as the vectors that created them. In VCarve, there is only the 3D model. In most cases, the Celtic Weave is represented as a square, a circle, an oval, or a rectangle. I'd like to show you how you can create your own custom shape Celtic Weave. Something you can add to your bag of tricks. I will tell you this process includes drawing vectors as well as node editing. It's a perfect lesson if you'd like to sharpen your skills in those areas. So let's get started. For this example, I'm going to use a rectangular shape with four protruding arcs, top and bottom, left and right. Between the two vectors is where I'd like to place the new Celtic Weave design. The distance between the two is 1.5 inches. I'm going to use my inner vector and offset it by 3/4 of an inch, so I basically have a center line. I then am going to take that same inner vector and offset it by 1/4 of an inch. And the outer vector, offset it inward by 1/4 of an inch. You'll see why these measurements are important in this design. Certainly, you can adjust it as need be. The next step is to create a triangle. And this triangle is important in the overall design concept. The size of the triangle is going to be 3/4 of an inch. That's half the distance of our space that we want to place our Celtic Weave in. I want it to be 3/4 of an inch in both width and height, so I adjust it manually and I delete the bottom vector. So in a sense, I now have more of a chevron than a triangle. Again, these are measurements that I came up with for specific size and design. You may want to play around with different sizes of the triangle so that you can get the results you're looking for. I'm going to take my center line vector and I'm going to cut it apart so I only have the top vector. That's all we're going to work with now, simply because once it's completed, I could flip it to the lower side of this rectangular border. I take my triangle, I hold my shift key down and click on the top vector, and I'm going to copy that triangle along that vector with a distance of 3/4 of an inch between each one. So basically, they're going to be touching end to end. You may need to go in and make a few adjustments to some of the triangles that need a little bit of tweaking, especially where it starts to turn the corner. Simply click on the chevron you want to adjust and move it. There's no rules about how this can be done. It's more the overall look of evenness that's important. For the sake of the video, I'm not going to be doing all of this border step by step, but maybe the first 5 or 6. I'm going to select one of the chevrons and I'm going to offset it outwards by 1/4 of an inch. Now here comes the tricky part. I don't believe you can select all of them and just offset them because there's an overlapping vector and you wind up having problems. So one of the options is to do them one by one and offset outwards by 1/4 of an inch. Or I could have selected every other one and offset those so there is no conflict or overlapping vectors. I'm now going to create a new layer entitled Arcs, and I'm going to change the color. I'm going to be using a lot of layers in this project. And with that layer active, I'm going to draw an arc starting at the top of the chevron and moving it to the right to where it intersects the offset of the adjoining chevron. And I'm going to do this for each chevron, starting at the top and going to the right. If this was a simple straight line of a weave, I think I could do offset and array. But since there's curvature included in the design, I'm not quite sure if it can be done with that process. So it may need to be done piece by piece. We're going to do the same thing to the bottom of the chevron. So I need to extend the left side of the chevron offset just so I know where the arc is going to end up. I'm going to place an arc and I'm going to start it on the right-hand bottom side of the chevron. And my guideline, that quarter inch offset from the inner vector, that acts as a guide. And as you can see, the two quarter inch offsets from the initial original vectors, the inner and the outer, are simply acting as guides to know how far my arc needs to bend. This last one, I'm going to just estimate where it's going to go. So, at this point, we can get rid of the large offset chevrons. They were simply used as guides to know where the arc is going to stop. Now, for the next step, we're going to be using the Explode Vectors gadget from within the software. We'll take the original chevrons and cut them apart so they are individual vectors and place them on their own layer called exploded vectors. So instead of having a joined vector chevron, we're going to have individual vectors. Hang in there, you'll get to see the logic of this. I now want to join the left side of the chevron and the top arc to make one vector. I can use join with a straight line or join in a common point. And I continue the same process with the right side of the chevron, the right side vector and the bottom arc, and join them together. I create another layer, I name it top offset, and change the color. Again, we have that issue of if I chose all of the vectors I wanted to offset, we'd run into some overlapping problems. So to try to make this as quick as possible, I select every other vector, and I offset that a quarter of an inch. How did I arrive at these numbers? A couple examples from within the software, which includes a Celtic weave, gives me some basic dimensions of how they turn and weave in and out. And we're going to do this with each of the vectors. Offset them outwards a quarter of an inch. And we'll repeat this process with the bottom vectors. Here's the example if I selected them where they were too close to one another and tried to offset. could see the end result is not what I asked for. The overlapping vectors are eliminated and deleted. So, selecting every other vector and offset is a quicker way. It's a repetitive process and a bit time-consuming, but worthwhile in the end because you wind up with a unique weave around your custom shape. The next step would be to join the common vectors together to create one undulating vector. Again, I go back to if I selected all the vectors and tried to join them as one group, I think there would be issues. So doing one at a time sometimes is the best way. You may find some shortcuts, and I hope you do. I'd love to see how yours turned out. Once you're done joining the vectors, check for the nodes. Try to make sure you have the least amount possible. And in this case, at the very ends, I'm going to extend them out so they overlap the intersecting vectors. There's our shapes that we're going to work with. I can turn off certain layers so it becomes a little bit clearer. I'm going to delete the unnecessary vectors at this point. If I was doing this in real life, I would have needed those chevrons to continue the weave across my design. I'm going to take this set of vectors and copy them to a new layer to work on. I try not to delete too many things, because in my case, I never know when I'm going to need that design. I take the top set of vectors. I'm going to offset them outward by 0.04 inches. This number is random. It will give you the spacing between the two vectors that you would require for the V carving. I don't know what number would work. It's going to be by trial and error, but from my eye, the 0.04 of an inch looks appropriate, and I offset. I then choose the bottom vectors and offset them in the opposite direction, the same amount. Our next step is probably the most crucial. We're going to need to do some clipping. The first thing we need to do is find the shape that's the most common. And I'm going to look at that J, that inverted J shape on the top left-hand corner. And I'm going to find that as it repeats itself throughout the design and eliminate the vectors that intersect it. And I'll do the same with the bottom J. You can start to see it magically appear. Just a note, if you hold your left mouse key down while you're using your snipping tool, you can delete the vectors at a much faster rate. Now we need to do a little bit of trimming. This is where it becomes tedious. We delete the extra vectors that we don't want. Takes a little bit of practice and a little bit of insight, and a little bit of thought of what you need and what you don't need. But with some practice, you get pretty good at it. Once you've completed your snipping process, this is the end result. A nice, clean set of vectors. If I continued with the process along the top vector, this would be the end result, which I can then use and flip to the bottom. So let's review. We have our vectors, our inner vector, and our outer vectors, the chevrons, that we exploded, we offset them before we exploded them, we created the arcs for the left-hand side of the chevron and the arcs for the right-hand side of the chevron, joined them together, offset those, and created an undulating vector. This is the end result. Please know that the corners, or any time it changes direction, may need an extra little bit of tender loving care, some node editing, and vector cutting. So let's take a look at another example, a heart shape. I envision this being the top lid of a box. It's the same process as we've just gone through. We have our vectors, our inner vector and outer vector, our centerline vector, and our two guidelines, each quarter inch offset. We create our triangle, or chevron, and copy it along that centerline vector. Make adjustments as needed. Offset those chevrons outwards a quarter of an inch. Create our left-hand side vector with arc, and create our right-hand side vector of the chevron with an arch. Each of those would get offset by a quarter of an inch. Again, it's a repetitive process, tedious at times, and certainly challenging, but I think it opens up a door of great possibilities of shapes. I'm sure there are shapes that are going to be more difficult to create, but you're certainly not limited now to circles, squares, ovals, and triangles. This was the before vectors, once completed, and this is what it looks like after. You can see the subtle changes that I made to the vectors, simply by node editing. Once I'm happy with all the vectors, we can create the toolpaths. Since I was using a rough sawn piece of lumber, I created a pocket first, and then my V-carving of the Celtic weave. This is the end result. I then took it a little further. I created two extra sets of vectors. Again, I did a pocketing, and selecting all the vectors, I created the V-carving with a flat bottom. And now my Celtic weave isn't simply a V-carve, but now has a pocket with V-carved sides of the Celtic weave. Ready for some special treatment, maybe some resin in those pockets, something that maybe looks like turquoise or silver. It could be quite attractive, much like an inlay would be. This is just a quick sample of what I did for my machine. Rough piece of lumber. This was more of an experiment to see if it was possible than anything. I hope you learned a little bit about how you can extend the possibilities of Celtic weaves. If you'd like to learn more about the software, subscribe to our channel and don't forget to click on the bell to be reminded of our new videos. And of course, as always, if you need help, send me an email, mm@mezalick.com. I'll be glad to help. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Enjoy.